Hachette Audio presents The Latecomers, written by Helen Klein Ross, read by Polly Lee, Vanessa Johansson, Robert Petkoff, Lauren Fortgang, Kevin T. Collins, Sarah Franco, and Sarah Mollo-Christensen. Includes a PDF of the Hollingworth family tree. This novel is dedicated to my Irish-American mother, Margaret Whalen Klein. For Catherine and Margaret, too. And of course, for Donald. One tree is black. One window is yellow as butter. A woman leans down to catch a child who has run into her arms this moment. Stars rise. Moths flutter. Apples sweeten in the dark. Even Boland, this moment. Author's note. Although many of the events that take place in this story are historical occurrences, this novel is a work of imagination. As Muriel Spark observed, it is a blow to a novelist's pride of invention if readers think otherwise. But as I live in a small town in Connecticut in a house similar to the one described, perhaps it is necessary to say that the characters and the town they occupy are works of fiction, not disguised biography. While the story isn't fact, I hope it rings true for readers who believe, as I do, that fiction is the conduit of our deepest truths.
Prologue. Emma. Upper East Side, Manhattan, September 2001. Emma pushed through the door of the ladies' room by reception and turned on a tap and held her palms upward, letting cool water run over the veins in her wrists. The trick Arlette had taught her when she was in pre-K, to calm herself. When Emma came out, there was her mother. Her mother was usually careful about looking her best when she came uptown to Thatcher. But now, her mascara was running, her lipstick was gone, her face was wet with sweat and tears. Her mother hugged her and, for once, Emma hugged back, taking refuge in her arms as if she were a little kid instead of a freshman in high school. Her mother said she was there to take her home. Suddenly, girls around them were talking, saying that Emma and her mother could come home with one of them. They all lived so close, only blocks away. But Emma wanted, for once, the same thing her mother wanted, which was to go home. She hoped her father would be there. She knew her mother was hoping this, too. When they got to the street, they saw that many stores had already closed. Hastily lettered signs were taped to accordion gates, closed due to today's circumstances. "We'll need money," her mother said. But the ATMs they passed were down until further notice. Long lines snaked from banks and from payphones. Later, Emma found it ironic that the parents who had resisted giving their kids cell phones were finally persuaded to change their minds by the events of a day on which cell phones proved useless. A huge crowd had gathered in front of the electronics store. What was on sale that so many people would take this moment to line up for? Then she saw. They were watching the TVs in the window. Emma and her mother stopped to watch, too. News was coming so fast, it had to be reported in what looked like ticker tape running across the bottoms of screens. South Tower collapsed. They watched the tower come down again and again. Each time it fell, Emma was flooded with gratitude that her father worked in the other one. But then, they showed footage of the North Tower, and she felt a stinging at the back of her eyes. Windows in the towers were designed not to open, yet it looked like people were leaning out of them. Dark spots drifted down the sides of the building. Emma guessed it was debris from the fire. But then the camera zoomed in and she saw the dark spots were people. People were jumping. Some fell upright. Some arched as they descended, doing backward Cs like victory jumps. And Emma closed her eyes and did what she hadn't done since she was a child. She reached for her mother's hand. Her mother squeezed it and brought the back of Emma's hand to her lips. Emma felt certain that her father wasn't one of the jumpers. He'd never have jumped, since it would have meant jumping away from them. When they got to the subway at 86th, a sign at the entrance read, "No more service today." They headed to 3rd, where, going against traffic, they saw an army tank? Had a war started? Her mother raised her arm to hail a cab. There were no cabs in sight. But after many changes of lights, a slightly battered car stopped in front of them. Car service. Emma's mother opened the back door, and Emma slid across several rips in the vinyl, making room for her mother. But she didn't slide in. "Take this to 125th Street," she said to Emma, fishing a 20 out of her wallet. "Take the train to your grandfather's. Wait at Hollingwood until I come up with Daddy." At the sound of Daddy, Emma's eyes filled. "No," Emma said, pushing the money away, sliding back across the seat toward her mother. "I'm staying with you. I want to go home." "They're not letting anyone south of 14th now. Do this for me, Emma. I can't worry about you two." She shoved the bill into Emma's blazer pocket. The car pulled away, and Emma heard from speakers in the dashboard, "The National Guard on alert. Fear of biological hazards." Alone in the back seat, she started to cry. She imagined her parents breathing in poisoned air, catching some terrible, fatal disease. And what about her cat? She had an appointment with the orthodontist later, but how straight your teeth were didn't matter anymore. Traffic was terrible. It took a long time for the car to get 40 blocks north to the station. The driver and she didn't talk. They just listened to the news. When Emma pulled the bill from her pocket and handed it across the front seat, the driver didn't take it. "Keep it, Peaches," he said. "I'm not car service. I just stopped at the light. But you take care. You do what your mama says." "Thanks," she nodded, thinking his kindness would have seemed extraordinary on any day but this. Were trains still running? Were her grandfather and Arlette safe? Hollingwood had stood in Wellington, Connecticut, since her great-great-great-grandfather built it in 1853. Would it still be there?
Part 1. 1. Bridey. Hollingwood, October 1927. That morning, hours after the cock crowed but before the town hall bell chimed 8, Bridey mounted narrow steps leading up from the kitchen, holding tight to the fluted handles of a silver oval on which Mr. Hollingworth's breakfast quivered. Serving gloves weren't insisted upon at Hollingwood, as they were in the big houses on Fifth Avenue, where a friend from home worked, but Bridey sometimes wore them anyway. It spared prints on the silver, which saved time in the long run. The trays and pouring pots needn't be polished so often. Mr. Hollingworth's breakfast was meagre fare compared to the morning feasts she and Nettie used to cook up. Blood sausages and custards, fruited popovers and muffins, eggs poached and scrambled and over easy or hard, depending on how he and his 4 children preferred them that day. But that was years ago, when the children were children and breakfasts were rollicking starts of days in the dining room instead of quiet meals for an invalid who spent most of the time in bed. A poached egg on toast is what she was carrying now to Mr. Hollingworth, along with a pot of coffee and a pitcher of cream she'd skimmed from the top of a bottle.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.